I'm Adam McKay, the director of Anchorman, a co-writer.
And I'm Will Ferrell, the other co-writer and star of the major motion picture Anchorman.
This is the unrated version of the commentary.
This is the uncensored version.
I'm going to get the ball rolling just by saying shitballs.
And I think that's a great choice.
Thank you.
Because shitballs is, you know, something we can all kind of wrap our arms around.
Well, it's playful.
It's playful, but it's not too dirty. It's still dirty. It's definitely dirty.
Should we take it up a notch? I mean,
that's where we kind of don't know. We're in this weird gray area. What are the limits? You know, in this post Janet Jackson era, where can we go exactly?
John Ashcroft sort of time of.
Can you say
fuck?
Can you say fuck?
I think you can.
You can definitely say crap.
Oh yeah.
You could say
bitch.
Bitch. Whore. Bitch whore.
Yeah, right? I know you can say that.
But can you say fuck a walrus? Can you say that?
I think you can. Now the question is, can you say face covered in Doberman's?
Right.
I don't think you can.
Dipped in shit.
Dipped in shit.
That one you probably can't say. So that's where we are.
It's a tricky thing as we see
really
the
is.
Opening credit sequence rolling here. How filthy can we be?
Yeah.
I mean, can we say veiny purplish?
On a platter with a side of diarrhea.
Maybe don't wear a bra next time.
I don't know. I mean, someone's going to make this call at some point.
Yeah.
I mean, you've picked this up. This is the unrated version. Hopefully you knew what you were in for.
Yeah, hopefully you are not shocked. If you are, I'm going to shock you even more by saying unshaven whale's vagina.
How's that? How's that fit?
Which
I'm going to...
was used in the movie, you'll find later.
But certainly the phrase unshaven wasn't. Or did you say shaven or unshaven?
Unshaven.
Oh, unshaven.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to say man...
What about dick salad? Can you say dick salad?
I think
once again, shitballs, dick salad.
Well,
it's
here's
fun.
The trick.
It's
you
fun.
Say dick salad, it sounds like a phrase. If you say literally a leafy green salad with three or four... arrayed on top of it?
Right.
Does that push it up a notch? Because it's getting a little more graphic.
Yeah, it's more articulate and more vulgar at the same time. It's weird that you'd get... It's odd that you'd get more articulate and it's more vulgar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's strange. Dick salad. Literally a Caesar salad with three or four grown male adult laid across it.
Tossed into it. Yeah.
But clearly
clear. No doubt about it. It's like you walk into the restaurant... And there are four in your Caesar salad.
How's this work? I mean, if I said bald man with a beard...
Mm-hmm. Taking a shit.
Taking a shit while a Doberman pinchers...
Does that cross a line?
That's bad. That feels wrong.
That does.
That feels like... is taking this off the shelf with that.
That means you get a sticker saying... illicit...
Yep.
Vulgarity.
Do not mark it.
Do not.
That takes it off the shelf.
Do
I don't know. That feels
this.
Like it, but I could be wrong. This could now be playing on the commentary, and someone's purchased this.
Yeah.
What
it's a real. It's a real gray
it's interesting.
Area.
It's a real gray area. It's very interesting.
It really is interesting once you get into it to break it down.
Now I know if we stray into religious territory,
that's
immediately a no.
Immediately.
I know that if we go in towards talking about people of authority,
right,
presidents, people like that, that's going to be trouble.
Yeah.
But, now on the other hand, what about Uncle Sam, the figure of Uncle Sam? Is that a sacred figure?
Is that?
I don't know. I mean, once again, it's tricky. But once
people,
I'm going to back way off that.
I think the people around here are supporting us.
Someone's banging one of our two producers are in the control room right now giving us thumbs down.
Yeah.
They're very worried about the area we've strayed into. I'm gonna get a little close to it.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna say Uncle Sam eating a bowl of shit. Oh, they're giving big thumbs down.
So big thumbs down.
So
you can't say that.
But that's bad. But Uncle Sam's a ridiculous character.
It's a fictional character.
It's not like the flag or anything sacred. It's a fictional, silly recruiting character.
Right.
Let's back off with that. We'll back way off that. Let's say this. Let's try this on for size. Let's say a line of 12 sacks of balls all lined up. Just that.
Sacks, 12 sacks of balls lined up.
12 sacks of balls lined up. Clean-shaven balls. Let's say that. 12 shaven sets of balls.
How about, let's say this. Now I'm going to really get into a weird area. Let's take the sanctity of a holiday like Christmas.
Okay.
And let's say you go and you check your Christmas stocking one morning. And you got 12 pairs of unshaven balls in your Christmas stocking.
That's tricky.
That's just a weird, odd thing.
Let's say this.
Now that I've combined it, maybe it's people are going to find that vulgar.
Let's say you reach into your stocking.
Right.
And it's just full of shit.
It's full of shit.
And you pull out a shit-caked hand.
Well, a shit-caked hand clutching a $100 bill.
That's different than what can you say and not say. That's a mixture of emotions. Because one thing is like shit, and it, somehow you know it's clearly human shit.
Right.
And then you look at your hands.
You wake up in your upstairs bedroom from the aroma of human shit.
Caked inside your
stocking. That's what brings you down Christmas morning.
Yep.
The smell of human shit. Like, what happened?
Yeah, it's even like 5:30 in the morning. It's not even a normal wake-up hour.
Right.
And you just like immediately your eyes slam open.
Yeah.
Whoa. Someone took a shit in the house.
Someone definitely took a shit.
And I just remembered it's Christmas morning.
And it's Christmas morning.
What's going on?
So you wake up, you if you have a wife, you say, you know,
Honey,
it's Christmas morning. Wake up, someone took a shit in the house.
She says, what are you talking about? You run downstairs, you try and smell, you reach into the stocking, brownish kind of clay colored shit all over your hand, about a $100 bill in your hand.
Yeah.
Let's just throw this one out there. Let's imagine glorious kind of John Williams music, and then slow motion shots of big arcing shooting one after another in sequence.
Right.
Oh, I'm getting a big thumbs down.
A big thumbs down?
Really?
Really?
Why? That's a human bodily
arcing.
All right. Well, let's go. We'll back way up. We'll just go back to fucks. If you actually think about the term fucks, that's rougher.
What if you had to have a medical procedure to remove a stick out of your ass?
That's okay.
Yeah, but that's pretty intense.
Oh, if it's a real medical procedure, yeah.
What if the medical procedure, because the doctor's name happened to be Glenn Fuckman, was called the Fuckman procedure? To remove, it's called Fuckman anal surgery. That's what it's called, just because the guy's name was
I think you're still within the realm of this is a medical procedure. What if you had to go have the Fuckman procedure to remove a knight's metal gauntlet from your ass? See, there was
it wouldn't matter. Either way, it's something...
Well, I'm just throwing that in, so you don't think that matters.
No.
What if it was the Fuckman procedure to remove a shit-covered bowling trophy from your ass?
What if it was a shit-covered... cat's that you had to have removed from your ass.
Shauna just shook her head no. And once again, a massive thumbs up. You know what I'm learning here is there's two things going on in the control room. Judd, I think, has given up and is now thinking there's no way we're using this track.
Right.
Shauna is just on a purely prudish, non-functional level, kind of horrified by what we're saying.
Right.
But Shauna Robertson, one of our producers, is Canadian.
Is Canadian, so...
And I think the things we're saying now, you can be arrested for saying up in Canada.
Right.
It's weird. Yeah. Canada's a very liberal, progressive society in a lot of ways.
And yet they'll lock you up for the smallest.
But if you talked about a Doberman up in Canada, oh yeah, someone could shoot you.
Forget it.
Yep. Now this is your first encounter with Christina. It looks very lovely. Sort of a Veronica Lake kind of look. Yeah. And you're sporting, you're showing off your physique.
I'm showing off an orange sherbet robe.
Oh, isn't that nice? Half robe.
Half robe.
It's not even a full robe. I feel compelled to have, we have to be dirty, otherwise it's just normal commentary.
I'm wearing a fucking robe.
And you're fucking talking horse shit to Christina.
No. I'm holding, I was going to say something bad, and I stopped myself.
Let's say a fruity glass of owl.
Owl.
Fruity glass of owl.
mixed with wolf piss.
Mixed with some wolf urine. Wolf. Owl with a little layering of wolf. Smells of rich mahogany. Fucking shit, look at that.
God damn.
Fucking fuck fuck.
Fuck shit. Bitch.
Wow.
Bitch.
Bitch town, USA.
Bitch town.
Jack-o'-lantern full of Kodiak bear. Wow.
Yeah.
An orgy consisting only of members of the A team. Look at that.
Look at that. Look at that.
Man, look at that shit.
Large pepperoni pizza sprinkled with pubic hair. Right?
Is there anything more pathetic than us sitting around talking dirty like this? Is me cracking up laughing at that, a 36-year-old man. That does sound appetizing, though. Pepperoni pizza sprinkled with pubic hair? Actually sounds a little tasty.
It no joke, it sounds, like, pretty good.
It sounds delicious. If the pubic hair was kind of crisped, if it was a little burnt, I mean, you wouldn't want it fresh.
No. You want it cooked sanitized. You want it to be sanitized.
Yeah. Otherwise, you know, once it's sanitized, it doesn't matter that it's pubic hair. It's just
uh-oh, dog.
Dog.
See?
Oh, there's actually some nice dog coming up.
Do we have a shot of the dog?
Well, we actually almost got an rating because of this dog shot coming right there. Oh, it's coming up.
A little glimmer.
And
right
there you go.
Yeah.
And then we had to go frame by frame and reduce the amount of shots of the dog. Where is it again?
You should have enhanced it, maybe. Shouldn't you go on the other way?
Well, I think for the unrated version, I'm hoping they've blown up the picture of just a close-up of a dog.
Now, isn't there...
You know what's odd? I feel...
Isn't there a ratings rule where you can actually show, in an extreme close-up, 5 seconds?
Of there is.
Extreme close-up.
If it's disconnected from any sort of... It's called contextual uncertainty.
Uh-huh.
And if you show a medical shot of a man's... You can show it for 5 seconds, as long as it's not connected. You can also show animals doing anything sexual because they're not human.
Oh.
Do you remember the movie,
Sure.
They actually have a shot of a polar bear a mule in that movie.
For 5 seconds.
For 5 seconds, because they're not, it's not human. It doesn't matter. It's just nature. So you're allowed
to
do it.
How did they get that footage? I don't know the answer to that question.
It's on the commentary. I watch commentaries on every movie. They slickered the mule's in seal, bloody seal, and then they dulled down the polar bear's teeth.
How did the polar bear not kill the mule?
Because it had dulled teeth. They removed its claws. And mules also apparently have very large penises, peni.
So the polar bear strictly approached the mule as a source of food, not...
Strictly.
Okay.
But, being an animal, once it was there, once the mule was aroused, a certain dynamic evolved, and apparently the polar bear the mule for a good 40 minutes. And apparently the polar bear's hands were around the mule's back end, rubbing it and making groaning sounds. It's in... Check. You know what? If it's not in the theatrical release... Then it's definitely in the DVD. But you're allowed to do that. They're animals. The theory being, animals are animals. You have dogs that lick themselves. So what? We're not judging them. They're innocent creatures.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
Channel 4.
Look at that shitty cigarette.
That is. Oh, I'm in the midst of quitting smoking right now. I have a fucking patch on my arm, and if anyone out there is of an age where they consider smoking, don't fucking do it, you dickhead. Mother.
You mother dickhead, don't do it.
Once again, a warning against smoking, but it's the unrated version, so there's going to be a little salty language in there. Don't fucking smoke, you
You dumb little shit-eating turd. Don't pick up that pack of cigarettes.
Don't do it, because it sucks. They will kill you, and then you have to quit at some point, and it's miserable. You've never had that misery, because you never smoked.
No, I never have.
I mean,
I've smoked a lot of pole.
Yep.
And I'm just being funny, trying to be vulgar.
It's the unrated version.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the unrated version. Yeah.
But,
I actually, oh, the hell with it. I actually have
experimented with
it. Yeah. About 6 or 7 times. The unrated version, so I'll say it.
Yeah.
I've gone down on men about 6 or 7 times. I actually had a long affair with, and I can't name him because it's the DVD, with a certain power forward who used to play for the well, then I'll say.
Who's, if I remember correctly, a statuesque man.
Very statuesque. And had
led the league in rebounding for years.
Yep. And also had a very soft jumper, a deceivingly soft touch.
Big, broad shoulders.
And I was young. I was out of high school. I was 19. I lived in his guest house, and sometimes he'd have a rough road trip, and I'd make him feel a little better.
Nothing wrong with that.
No. Well, actually, quite a bit wrong with it. But yeah, yeah. So, Paul Rudd looking good in that fucking suit.
Looking really great in fucking green shirt.
Look at that fucking shithole office.
David Koechner describing how he'd like to bite into a little piece of ass.
Like, and then get a big old mouth full of rump.
Rump.
Bare white ass, bare fucking
white
ass cheek.
Ass. Mr. Harkin, maybe it's shaven ass or is it unshaven ass? You don't know.
You don't know. That's something you have to figure out. Yeah. I mean, it's fun not to know everything when you're talking about sex, to have a little bit covered up. Have some of it be a surprise.
Sure.
I personally like it. You know, you always like when it's covered up and part of it's the imagination. I like it when the only parts exposed are the sexual erogenous zone. So it's, in other words, a crotchless dress with the breast area shaved, to me, is very attractive, very sensual.
And then the person's veiled or you don't see any other...
A rubber mask, or a ski mask. Nothing more beautiful to me than a woman in a black evening gown with a ski mask and only her breasts and crotch exposed.
Well, it's very vulgar, and that's why we're talking about it.
It's unrated.
And it's unrated.
You know what? You walked into... Your 8-year-old somehow grabbed this unrated version and chucked it in your cart without you knowing it? Too bad. You're hearing this right now.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Oh, hey.
How you guys doing?
Hey. Is this the Clueless?
Hi.
Is that Chris?
Oh, wow, we're just joined by Andy Richter and Kyle Gass. What a...
Hey.
What's up, man?
What
how
a pleasure.
You?
Hi, guys.
How you guys doing?
Good
to see you, too.
Yeah, I was down the hall. We were doing a NutriSlim voiceover, and we heard you guys were in here.
Oh,
doing
welcome!
That.
Yeah, we're just.
What are you doing? Are you doing,
we're doing
the
commentary on Anchorman?
I heard this so funny, you guys. I heard it's really
I've
good.
Yeah, it's really good too. I haven't seen it yet.
You guys should see it. Definitely.
Is it a period piece? Because it looks like the.
It's kind of vaguely 70s, 60s.
Yeah, I read this. I don't know if you remember, but I auditioned.
You had a really funny audition, yeah.
Yeah, I kind of figured... Yeah. I mean, first of all, I was surprised that I had to audition. And then, double surprised. I didn't get a part in a movie.
Well, it was... As you can see, we cast a lot of our friends are in it, like Dave Koechner and...
Yeah, that's Lennon. What I'm getting at. You and I... How long have we known each other?
God, we've probably known each other 10, 12 years.
Yeah, we saw. Oh, is this the... Jack had a cameo in this.
Did he?
Everybody had cameos, didn't they?
A lot of people,
like every male in Hollywood that you guys knew, right? Didn't you call in all your favors?
Called in all your... Yeah. All your chits.
I mean, we... I don't know if it was favor. You know, we just...
Well, you know how it goes. I mean, we'll all do movies together in the future and stuff. Right. And you guys did Elf with Will.
Yeah, we were great.
You guys were really great.
We were the guys.
Yeah,
in
you
Elf.
Guys were the writers.
He was like guy one. Yeah, I was guy two. I just thought that I thought that we'd really started something with Elf.
Why couldn't you just throw us a bone and just put us in it?
What Mary Band or something, you know?
Is it like, what, you know what, we're not funny enough for the thing?
You're going to have to ask Adam. This is kind of in history.
Adam,
story.
Is this about the D thing? Because we didn't hire you for the stupid movie?
Because I really did want
your stuff was funny. It was just disjointed. I couldn't follow it. It just wasn't right for the project.
I wanted you guys in the movie. I really did.
All right. It's not a big deal.
I just didn't think you'd want, like... comedians in the movie, not people like Paul Rudd. Yeah, he's about as fucking funny as, you know, all my children.
I mean,
hello?
Hello?
Yes.
Oh,
who's this?
Who's
This is Paul Rudd.
Oh, hey, Paul.
Hey, Paul, what's up? It's Adam.
Hey, Adam, how are you?
Hey, Paul, it's Will.
Hi, Will.
Hey.
Good to talk to you.
Yeah.
Who are those other jokers you got in there in that studio that I've been listening to?
Really funny.
A little too long.
Really funny, Paul.
Paul, this is Adam again. There's Paul, no one else other than just me and Will.
It's Andy Richter, Paul. It's not,
Andy Richter.
Yeah. Is it me again? And
Kyle
Gass is here too.
Andy Richter. He's great. Yeah. Andy, you were the one that was questioning my mustache, right? Or was that Kyle? Is that Kyle also?
I believe that was Kyle. Yeah. Hey,
that
Paul.
That was totally Kyle. Paul. That is so I would cool. never do that.
Did you really grow that for the movie? It looks so good.
Oh, you're really good. I get it. So you're interested now. Yeah. No, I did. I did. That's what I do. I mean,
you know what?
I'm
funny
an actor,
look.
And there's that's why I got cast. I don't know why.
Were you busy today and you couldn't come in?
Obviously, Andy. Adam hasn't seen your work on Quintuplets and.
Guys.
And Kyle, as for you, I don't know. They obviously hadn't seen your Scenelet. I don't want to say scene it like a scene from Scenelet in Saving Silverman. That was really, really
okay. They did say I kind of stole the movie in that one. Thank you, Paul.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Paul. I'd insult your career, but I'm not at home in my underwear in front of IMDb.com.
Well,
so I can't look
guys,
up
this
your.
This is just really unnecessary.
You really nailed me. Andy, because that's what you need to get on imdb.com to actually see what you've been in.
All right.
No, guys, there's right. like there's like
you know,
two
first of all,
websites devoted to some of the stuff that I've done, and some other stuff too.
I'm a little upset. I know that we all.
Paul, we're sorry you had to hear this. We didn't know these guys were coming.
I thought we were friends. I did grow a mustache. I did audition for the movie. I did Pippin at the Round Wharf 10 years ago, and I've been struggling and working. Really
Paul, you don't have to do this. You don't even have to do this. You don't have to defend yourself.
You don't have to at all. These guys were on the attack and unfairly.
Paul, you're in the movie.
I don't mean to sound short or flippant or insult those other guys that are in there. It's just it hurts.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to hurt that much. They're just.
We're bitter.
The commentary. They want to see like how it goes. They want to hear what's going on with the actors. And like,
absolutely.
We had a fun time making that scene. Steve Carell laughed so hard he thing came out of his nose. But they get this, and this is not what people spend a lot of money.
And if Will and I didn't have to get out of here real fast, we would back up and redo this.
Yeah. But we don't have the time.
No, can you? I mean, you really?
No, we don't have the time.
We're watching your Sex Panther scene right now with the cologne, and
it's doing great.
Yeah, we had fun making that scene.
You know, the sideburns do look awesome.
It was nice, man.
They really. I'm serious about that, and I'm. I'm nice, sorry that's
a,
about.
That's a nice gesture.
Is that the chick from Married with Children? She's hot.
You know what, guys? Maybe you guys should leave.
Hot.
Yeah.
Maybe
you
guys
get in on some of that. Did you get on that?
Maybe you guys should get out of here.
Thank you,
Paul. What are
you
talking about? Oh, so now we're not in the movie, and now we can't even be in your stupid little commentary to sell your stupid movie?
Well, it was never
intended. You're not
making
enough money, Will?
You know what, man? Get out. Hey, Kyle.
Is this going to be on Inside the Actors Studio?
Get out. You get out.
Oh, you know what? Go back to SNL, you failure. Come on, man. Let me call up.
I make a lot of money. I'm not going to lie.
Hey, I can do Quintuplets. No. Ow. Ow. Get out.
Man.
I hate you.
Get him out of here.
Career's over.
Oh my God, Paul! You would not believe your nose is just bleeding. It's gushing. That's like weird blue blood coming out of your nose.
That's
like brain blood coming out of his
cranial
nose.
Cranial fluid.
Should I go too now?
Let's get out.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Let's stay in here. One more for you.
It's cranial fluid.
Real second rate, guys. Real second rate.
It's Bush, is what it is.
Bush league stuff.
Can't wait for Anchorman Part 2.
Seriously, guys.
It's actually kind of cool idea.
If that
the French thing,
or if the beach volleyball thing pans out, let me know.
Really? All right.
I'm starting to taste metal. I'm starting to taste just a little bit of metal.
Man, that is weird blood. Let's take a break.
I'm a little shocked. I just even over the phone, I haven't heard an argument like that since the commentary for Kissing Jessica Stein.
Paul, we may need to take an affidavit from you because I was assaulted, and although you didn't hear it or see it, you did hear it.
There'll be a guy coming by your house tomorrow to depose you.
The only way to bag a classy lady is to give her two tickets to the gun show.
Wow.
I can't. I can't stand up.
You stuff it up with paper or something.
Yeah.
You know what he did? I realized he had, like, the tip of his finger whacked the tip of your nose. He got, like, so much torque on it. Because that is like
I really got up in there.
That is a deep red blood coming out now. I've never seen blood like that.
Oh, it hurts so bad.
Oh, wow. Oh, it's all over your shirt. Yeah, that's a
nice. This is a $1,000 shirt, too.
Oh, what? Really? This looks like a t-shirt. Oh, man. Those guys were...
Have you ever seen anything like that before?
I've never seen anything like that. I just... To behave like that. There's no way I'd want to work with them again. I mean... Kyle, just his hand was like a blur when he hit you. How many times did he hit you, like, 5 times in, like, 3 seconds? It was so quick.
Now, when we run into them again, it's going to be just awkward and weird and...
I'm just going to play it off like everything's cool and nice, but in the back of my mind, like, there's no way I'm ever doing anything socially or...
No, I'll never bring it up again. I'll be totally cool, too, but...
Maybe with Richter, but Kyle, after what he... Look at that, man. There's, like, pieces of something in that blood.
That's cartilage. Do you know what cartilage looks like?
I've never seen it not connected to the body yet.
I bet you it's cartilage.
I think he like pulverized the cartilage in your nose or something. It was just hunks of it coming out. Oh man, your nose is like collapsing.
Yeah. It's collapsing.
There's like no structure to it now. Looks like a used bloody condom on the front of your face or
I hate to say we should stop the tape, but maybe we should just stop the tape.
I really want to finish this. I want to knock this off.
Okay.
Let's just finish this break. Let's just finish this break.
Okay.
Finish up, do another section, take another break, and then let's just get out of here.
If I pass out, though,
I'll cover
you.
For
know you.
Why? Yeah. Oh man, you know your pupils are weird too. They're like pinpoints.
Really?
And all the whites in your eyes are just red. It's like there's no white.
I can't focus on anything right now.
Really? I think you have a concussion. I think your brain might have hit against your skull or something.
You know,
I
mean, you have to keep me awake.
He hit you so hard.
You have to keep me awake.
How do you handle a head wound? I think you're supposed to eat and sleep when you have a head wound. Is that it? All right, take a nice nap. Here, you know what? Eat this.
Don't let me fall asleep.
Here's some of that. I have this cheese sandwich. Eat
if
some
I
of this.
I have a concussion. Don't let me fall asleep.
Is your stomach sore? Come on, have a nice nap. Go to sleep.
No, don't let me fall asleep.
Go to sleep.
Why are you doing this? It's so
you
sleep.
Have a head wound. Go to sleep. I'm letting him sleep. In the back, he has a head wound.
Did you let me fall asleep?
Yeah. I said
why
hello
did you do that? We think I might have a concussion.
I think you're supposed to sleep when you have a head wound.
No, you're supposed to keep me awake. I could never... There's a chance I would never wake up again. Do you realize that?
I don't think so, man. I think when you have a head wound, you're supposed to... Isn't the expression, if you have a head wound, right to bed, sleep tight, everything will be all right? Isn't that like an old saying?
I've never heard that.
It's the old one, too. More than 8 drinks...
I don't think so.
Less than 8 drinks, don't drive your car. More than 8 drinks, drive so far. Have you ever heard that?
Mm-mm.
If you have a handgun and children in the house, keep the handgun
quiet
underneath,
as a mouse.
Quiet as a mouse and underneath the coffee table for all to see.
That one's standard. That one I've heard before.
You have heard that before?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
All right, should we go back to doing this thing? I just want to finish it. I really just want to get out of here.
Believe me, I want to get out of here more than... anyone.
Alright. I'll go tell him to start running again and
Have you been to the river before?
What do you mean?
Out to the river, Colorado River, you know, little jet ski, little fun in the sun.
No. Why are you doing that?
That's where I'm going next.
Oh, you're going there next?
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm going in 20 minutes.
Oh man, I think we got more of the movie left
well,
than that.
Well, I'm going in 20 minutes. I get in a helicopter and I fly out to the
Don't
river.
Don't do that. You're doing the commentary. Just finish it.
So you go, quote unquote. I'll be doing the commentary from the inside of my helicopter.
That's impossible with the noise and everything.
Because that's the way I do it now, and it feels good.
Man,
it feels good to
you
just.
You take that helicopter everywhere.
Yeah.
I saw that when I was at your house too. You have just a crew on standby. The helicopter's always idling.
Yeah, and it's not cheap.
You have the helicopter idling all night long while you're asleep.
I have it. Not only is it idling, it's hovering about a foot and a half off the ground.
At all times?
Around the clock.
Why is that?
Just so I can be ready at a moment's notice to go anywhere.
Man.
But that's where I am right now in my life, and it feels
good. How much did, I mean, it's we're not doing the commentary. How much did you make last year?
How much did I make?
Yeah.
Nine, maybe ten.
10 mil? I'm sorry, I'm trying. Is that what you're talking, 10 mil?
No, no, no. I made 9,000 a month. 9 or 10,000 a month.
So you made like $100,000 last year?
I don't know, I'm not a mathematician.
That's not that, that's a lot of money for most people.
It's a lot of money.
Don't... But it's surprisingly low. I thought you were going to say 9 or 10 million. No. Well, you know what, let's go back to this. All right.
Okay. May I take your order?
Yes, I am going to have three fingers of Glenlivet.
This is Adam McKay, the director of Anchorman.
And I'm Will Ferrell, the star and also the co-writer. We just want to welcome you back. And of course, right now we're joined by none other than Mr. Lou Rawls.
Hello, I'm Lou Rawls.
Lou?
And I'm still trying to figure out what I'm doing here.
Well, I think Adam says it best.
I just think you're Lou Rawls. I think there's no way the second we knew we were doing a commentary, the first thing we said was we have to get Lou Rawls here.
Really?
We wanted it to sound professional and right. So, thank you for joining us.
No, thank you for inviting me.
Yeah.
Yeah, so far, how's it going?
Well, we've had some rough moments.
We have, yeah, to be honest.
To be honest with you, Lou.
Yeah. Some people came in and didn't really behave quite well, and there's been a lot of rough moments. It hasn't gone well at all. And 1 to 10, I give it about a 2.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Well,
so that's... we're hoping you can kind of right the ship, Lou, if you could help us out here.
I see. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, is this like 70s, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. Cool.
Does this harken back any memories for you, Lou?
Mm. Well, early morning radio.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's, I guess you could say it's kind of tongue-in-cheek.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like to think it's a little more serious than that, but I mean, well, I don't want to get into splitting hairs. Mm. I call it, I always refer to it as a docudrama.
Docudrama?
Yeah.
Lou, why are you laughing?
Well, because I'm trying to figure this one out.
Oh, my character plays a little jazz flute here.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Huh?
You know, we almost had a Hubert Laws. We actually met with him to do this flute solo.
Oh, yeah?
We went and hung out with him for an afternoon.
Oh.
Had a glass of wine with him and his cousin over at his house, and never quite happened, but...
Did y'all drink too much wine?
We drank. I had too much wine. I don't hold my liquor well.
He doesn't.
No,
he doesn't.
No.
Oh. I do, though. Mm-hmm. So... anytime you want to share a bottle of wine, Lou.
Oh, yeah? All right.
Call me up.
I got you.
Did you ever play any instruments, Lou?
No, actually, no. I made an attempt at piano, but it didn't get very far.
All right.
Hmm.
So I just, I have a piano.
Oh.
It's beautiful.
What do you think? I've always wanted to play banjo.
Really?
But that's just me.
Oh. Yeah. Hmm. What do you think the most beautiful instrument is?
The voice.
The human voice?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
See, I think it's the wah-wah pedal.
The wah-wah pedal?
I mean, I don't know if that's really an instrument, but...
I don't think it is, actually.
Okay. Well, then a guitar with a wah-wah effect on it, I would say, is the most beautiful. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Or the CB? Does that count as an instrument? CB radio?
CB radio that truckers use?
Yeah,
I don't think that's
an
instrument.
No, okay.
That's not quite an instrument, although... Yeah. Some of those guys out there in those trucks, boy, they really got it going on.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, man. Talking about, what's your 20?
Sure. You know? What's your 20?
Yeah. Hang 10?
Yeah. No, that's not it.
No, not hang 10. That's...
10-4?
Yeah.
10-4. Double play?
No, 10-4, good buddy. That's what it is.
Double play? And you struck him out?
No, that's baseball.
I don't know. I'm just trying to... You're Lou Rawls. I'm a little nervous.
He's very nervous, right?
Yeah, you're Lou Rawls. You
know, well, yes.
So now, Lou, are you currently touring? Or are you always touring?
Oh, yeah, I'm always on tour. You know, it's... I consider that a blessing. Because
You were saying you still do 200 dates a year.
Just about.
That's great.
Close to it.
Do you remember, Lou, the age of the leather-backed chairs, the leather-backed booth?
The booth, oh, man, listen. When I first came down, I went to Brown Derby.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that was, I went there, and they had the booths, and they were saying, well, you know, Clark Gable sat in this booth, and I'm standing there looking around. And then they said, and over there, Frank Sinatra, that was his booth. I said, right, so I went over and sit down and rub myself around in the see if it rub off.
Well, I think it did.
Yeah, I got lucky.
Brown Derby doesn't... Does it exist anymore? I don't think it does.
No.
They knocked that down?
It's a parking lot.
Oh, jeez.
Musso and Frank's. That place has a red leather booth still, I think.
It's got maybe one or two, because... Yeah.
Lou, were there women as beautiful as that on the road when you were as beautiful as Christina when you're out touring around?
Probably.
Well, they probably were. You didn't get to see them too much.
No.
No.
Was it crazy? Is it crazy on the road? I mean, is it? Do you have like fans and groupies and?
Well, you have fans. The groupie days are still. That's for the, you know, the younger newcomers. You know?
I see.
But you have fans that have stuck with you for over the years, but for the groupie thing, it's not so much groupies now, because they done got too old to be groupies.
I see, I see. When you were coming up, though, was it crazy? Did you have the women waiting outside the dressing room and the...
Well, the places I was working in, they didn't have outside dressing rooms, because you usually had to dress in the men's room.
Oh, jeez.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
wow.
Hey, you know, this...
Small joint, yeah.
There's little small joints.
Yeah.
Where the stage was about 5 feet, you know.
And so you didn't really... Big enough to barely fit your band on there.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes your band had to play on the side of the stage because there wasn't no
Or sometimes
room.
The band had to play in the bathroom.
Well.
Wow.
It was weird. But it was fun, you know.
You know, Lou, actually, Will, one thing, he's very shy, and he won't brag about himself, but he's considers himself a master of scat. I don't know if you've ever heard this about him. He's done it on TV a few times.
Really?
Yeah, he's
pretty, I don't know if I'd say I'm a master.
He's pretty darn good. I've heard him do it before, and he's pretty amazing. I mean, do you scat? I mean, I'd love to hear you guys trade off, or...
Yeah, well, we did. I did some for the first time on the album I cut. I did an album called Raw Sing Sinatra.
Yeah.
And I did that song, you know, the song Ladies of Tramp.
Sure.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Ella Fitzgerald, man. She.
Oh, she's
she
amazing.
She was the queen.
Yeah.
You know. And for some reason, I don't know why, I was standing there in the studio, and when the instrumental solo started, I just started doing it. And I said, whoa, wait a minute, don't do this, because I'm not going to do this when I go out.
But, did it sound anything like this? Scabbity-boo-doo-ba-dabbity-boo-sabbity-bop-boop.
No, it sounded more like, oo-bop-cha-bop-da-bing-da-bang-doo-da-dee-dee-da-da.
I think mine's better.
You probably.
Do it again, Will.
Dee-ba-da-boo-doo-ba-ba-beep-boop-boop-boop.
Oop bop dooba lop dooba da da do bing a ding doo doon doon. That was, now that's...
Take it up a notch, Will. Bring in the big guns. Scat off.
Scat off.
Go, Will. Big guns.
Scat beep a boo dee ba 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 be ba be bo.
Oop bop and da bo dum dig it and do it and do it and do it and do it.
Scat beep a boo dee ba 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 dee.
Ooh bop shabam, a coogie bop bop, doodly bop, boodly bop, 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 bop.
I think Lou won. You know what? You're not actually that good, Will.
No,
that I heard him do it.
I never said I was good.
You say boop a lot.
I know.
You
like
gotta say other things besides boop.
Well,
he had like all kinds of different cool things. And
well, boop a lot. That's
funny. That's because he's a trained professional.
No, don't back off. You talk big about your scat. You've always said you can take down any singer on the planet with your scat.
I did talk. I talked way too big.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See? Well, you know, when you've got somebody behind you like I have this certain lady that is, whew, boy. Whoa, man. She is super fragilistic. Expialidocious. Man, you know.
This is a scene where they talk about what is love in the movie. How would you define love?
Do you really love the lamp, or are you just saying it because you saw it?
Do you really love the lamp? Well,
You really want to know what love is?
What is this? Yes, tell
us. You've sung about love a few times.
A few times, yes. I've had a few love songs in my life. Yeah. But what is love, really?
It's a good question. We define it through song. We sing Afternoon Delight.
Wow. Wait a minute.
You don't seem too impressed, Lou.
Everything's a little clearer in the light of day. You're kidding me.
Are you getting jealous now?
You're actually doing a full part harmony?
We're trying to.
Wow. Oops.
Oops.
Well.
Well, we tried. See?
Uh-oh. So exciting. Skyrockets
in flight. Afternoon delight. Now maybe we're back on track.
Boy, I got his knickers in a knot.
Well, see, that was our attempt to describe love.
What time of day was this? What's this?
What's the craziest fist fight you ever witnessed?
Craziest fist fight?
Because I know you grew up in Chicago and some, right, some tough times. Did you ever see, what's the craziest one you ever saw?
Oh, well, let's see. We could start off with one time I saw this girl punch this dude out.
Really?
And he was big.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was about almost, 6 feet tall and she was about 4'1".
Whoa.
And, it happened so fast. Like, we were standing there saying, boy, that chick better be cool, man, because that's a big dude, you know? And before we knew it, he was getting up off the ground. We said, whoa, what happened?
Do you remember what place?
Where it was?
Where it was?
Yeah. It was on 63rd and Cottage Grove on the south side.
Do you know where that is?
I know Cottage Grove.
He lived in Chicago
for a while. Yeah, I lived in Chicago for about 6 years. Yeah.
Really? Did you know Cottage Grove?
I've heard of, yeah. We used to go over to the south side to watch high school basketball all the time. That was our big thing.
Yeah.
We'd go to Harold's Chicken and go see some games.
Harold and Bales.
Yeah. And so this 4'1 woman knocked out this 6-foot dude.
Yeah. And, you know, because he had been, you know, shaking up and carrying on.
Oh, yeah.
And she,
so he deserved it.
Yeah, well, she turned around and said, that's all right. You can keep on doing it if you want to. And before we knew it, he was on the ground.
Whoa.
She was, we don't know where she hit him, but it must have been in the vital spots. Cause,
oh, man.
You know.
Right. Right. Read something like this.
I love. That's cute.
I think I wore some nice clothes in this movie.
Yeah, your wardrobe designer was pretty hip. That looks like a
nice little turtleneck.
Yeah. Nice little Anchorman outfit.
It's just tomorrow morning at 9 instead of 8.
Oh, almost forgot. I won't be able to make it, fellas.
See?
Veronica and I are trying this new fad.
Let me ask you something. Yeah. Why did you do the mustache thing?
Well, we just, I've always wanted to grow a mustache.
Really?
Number one. And number two, it just kind of fit for the character. Yeah.
What do you think, Lou? Do you think it looks good, or?
Well, it kind of makes you, I don't know, it just doesn't,
More distinguished or less?
Well, it has a distinguished look. Now, if you'd had sideburns a little longer, that would have,
I'm pretty good at reading people. It seems like you really like it. You seem excited about it.
Look at that mustache.
Look at that's strange. See,
yeah.
If we see you on stage with a mustache in the next year or two, you have to pay a finder's fee to Will.
Ah. Oh, that's something
about growing a mustache?
No, you know, actually, when I was singing gospel music, I had a little. Yeah. It didn't have a full one. I just had one of those, you know, like a wisp.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Right along the.
You know, just
the
right
lip
on
here?
The lip. Yeah, on the lip, you know.
See, the joke here is his sportscaster's in love with him. They just had a few too many drinks and blurted it out.
Oh.
Plays out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm going to quit saying things when they crop up there in the old skull, huh?
See what it's like when
awkward moment. When
you're not here. Yeah.
Strange.
Yeah.
All his friends are a little freaked out because he's in love with the new lady.
Oh.
I've left the news team.
She is just using you. Oh.
Just relax, all right? Believe me, if there's one.
What? How did you shoot this? You want to describe how you shot this scene?
We used a 34 millimeter Dutch lens, and it's a beautiful lens. It's a real honey of a lens.
No, I saw it.
Gets you right in there, and it's a ruby casing, and we actually used it on this scene right here.
Oh, look at
Yeah,
it
you
really
can
pops.
You can really see it.
It really pops.
It's called a Mahler lens. Mm-hmm. And there's only like six of them in the world. Mm-hmm. So to transport it across international borders, you have to have a team of four people with it.
Wow.
So it actually cost a pretty penny. I don't know if you're allowed to say budgetary things, but it cost $480,000.
Really?
Just for that one day of shooting. Yeah.
Well, it sure shows. It's
And it's one of those things that people won't notice. You know what? They notice.
It's great. And I think with the advent of DVD, how much more knowledgeable the moviegoer is. And to have distinct knowledge of lenses like
absolutely.
That, it really makes making that choice a lot easier.
Well, I'd say without exaggeration, there were six applause breaks in this movie just because of how beautiful something was shot.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, when we brought in the Longestino lens in the end, it pretty much carried our whole ending.
I don't know, Ron.
That's, you know... I don't know why, but I get a feeling like it's Chevy Chase with a mustache.
Yeah, a little bit. Sure. You know?
We had some bad reviews that said that.
Really?
So one or two. Yeah. It said Ted Baxter with a mustache.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ted.
who were the newsmen in Chicago when you were there?
Oh. Well, mostly.
You remember?
I don't really, because we never did watch television.
Yeah.
You know?
Bill Curtis, you remember? Because he narrated our movie.
Yeah.
Bill Curtis, he's from Chicago.
Oh. I know we had. Mostly we were like into the radio thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because you had. Sid McCoy and. Well, McKee Fitzhugh, you know, the radio, which is mostly R&B and jazz radio. I deserve the opportunity to take on more challenging stories. Well, ask. And television wasn't that interesting. Yes, this came across my
desk. Yeah.
Here's a story of a 103-year-old woman
out in Chula Vista. I don't think it's going to succeed, television.
Well, you know, when I was growing up there, we had one television in the neighborhood, and it was about a 20-inch screen, if that big.
Yeah.
So you figure it'd be maybe 25 or 30 people trying to watch that screen.
That little script, black and white.
Right.
You know, I never got a chance earlier, Will, to pitch my new movie idea for you. It'd be good to see what Lou thinks of it as well. I tried to tell you before, I've been trying to call Will for the past month.
Right.
Left about 80 messages on his machine. I guess his phone was busted. He didn't tell me this. But, But, yeah, I'm excited about it, and it's...
What's the idea?
Basically, you're an Eskimo, and you have to come to New York City and kind of make your way through New York City as an Eskimo.
Hmm.
And sort of like, it's warm here, and, you know...
What the hell, bro? An Eskimo in New York City?
Yeah, and that's what the movie's called. It's called An Eskimo in New York City.
Uh-huh. Well, that should be interesting.
Lou likes it.
I don't think Lou said he liked it. I think he said it would be interesting.
It would, but Eskimo in New York City, that would be,
So it's kind of a fish-out-of-water story.
Right.
Yeah.
What time of year? Would it be winter or in summer?
It'd be winter. So it'd be cold, but not quite as cold as these. But you know what? Actually, now that you say that, maybe it'd be funnier to have it be summer, so it'd be hotter.
Hmm.
A lot of jokes are about temperature in it.
Right.
It's kind of similar to what the Elf movie was a little bit like.
How so? No, you're an elf in that. That was like...
Yeah, but I came from a cold climate in the North Pole.
In this case, you're an Eskimo. You go to New York City and you get a job as a newscaster.
But that's... We already did that in this movie.
And then you're all your newscaster friends and you decide to start a fraternity again.
I don't know.
Yeah, well, you think that would work?
I think it's...
Do you want to go tomorrow and just sign it, get it done, and just set it up in development? Get some money?
Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
Hmm.
Lou Rawl, don't do this to me in front of Lou Rawls.
If Lou tells me I should do it, I'll do it.
But well, the thing is,
Lou, just please tell him he should do it.
Well, I would say based on what I'm sitting here looking at right now, I guess I would have some giggles.
You think so?
Yeah, I might have some giggles, you think?
So I just said yes.
Might have some giggles. You think you'd have some giggles, man?
Because, I mean, I'll be honest, we need the money pretty badly. My family and I, we've been eating dry oatmeal out of the box.
Oh, really?
Eggs, just raw eggs.
Wow.
Tap water.
What's up, guys?
Oh, Dave Koechner's with us.
Yeah.
Dave. How are you, Dave?
I just heard about this thing.
What how you doing, that? Man?
I'm good. I'm good. How are you?
Good to see you.
Wow.
Lou Rawls is here.
Lou, wow. Good I'll tell you what, a lot better now seeing you.
All right.
I might have an ally in the room.
Right. He played our sportscaster, Champ Kind.
Did I?
Oh, yeah?
Oh, you know what? Here's the thing. I didn't know I was in the movie.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I thought it was in the movie. But when I saw the assemblage of the movie, I was barely in it.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about that, man. You had some good moments in this movie.
I had good moments during the filming of the picture.
Really?
Yeah. But how's this doing for you, Will? Is this doing pretty well for you?
It's doing great.
You get a nice bump off of it?
What does that mean? I don't even know.
I mean, it's helping your career, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. I'm glad. I know it's helping Steve. I see that. Boy, he's really taking off. And Paul, lighten it up.
Yeah.
What's up? I needed this. I needed
this. David, I think this is inappropriate.
Oh, man, this is the commentary for the DVD. You see this mic hanging over
us here. Know what?
I came to talk to you guys. I came to have it out.
All right.
Oh, Dave, come on, man. No. Trust me, you will regret this. This will be on the commentary.
This is being recorded right now.
Lou Rawls
is here.
Lou Rawls
is here.
I respect Lou Rawls.
Well, thank you very much. But you know, I've been seeing a lot of promotion and stuff.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah, I wasn't in those ads.
I've seen you.
You are. You're in the print ad.
Barely in the ads.
You see you on the outside there.
I wasn't sure that was me.
No, I'm sorry you have to see this. And I have to do my job as a director right now, so pardon the way I'm about to behave.
Yeah, you know what? The reason it's cut out is because it didn't work. That's why. Bullshit! I'm supposed to put crap on the screen? I should have been in the editing room. I'm going to put crap on the screen because you messed my tooth thing up. My tooth just fell out.
You made his tooth fall out.
We're lucky this thing made any money.
Whoa.
Yeah, well, you know what? You're lucky we put your mangy ass in here. We dragged you out of Missouri or whatever crap hole you're from and put you in this. You brought me out here to make a fool of me. You're damn right we did, and we're laughing all the way to the bank. Well, you've done it. Where's mine? Where's mine?
Once again, Lou, we apologize for this.
Well, that's okay. Wait, this is getting interesting.
I didn't do this in front of Lou Rawls. It's not right.
See?
I wanted to confront you.
Well, you.
And I wanted to confront you.
And you did. You did.
Let's go back.
We can't go back.
No. We can go back.
You don't do that, David.
The movie's already out.
You don't do that.
Let's reissue it. It happens all of the time.
Maybe this is a gift for you. Maybe the career waning is a good thing. Spend more time with your kids.
I am selling shoes on the street.
I don't even understand how that's a job. That makes no sense.
I go to thrift stores and buy shoes. I jack up the price and sell them on the
street.
That
is a terrible business idea.
I put my son and my daughter right next to me.
Lou, you don't have to listen to any of this.
A scary dog, and we do very well.
A scary dog?
Well, it's a very thin dog. I don't feed the dog. I'm going to feed my kids.
Uh-oh. Mr. Rawls, have you ever received an honorary doctorate from a college? Can we call you Dr. Rawls?
Actually, yes, I have.
Dr. Rawls is here. You don't behave
this
way.
Behave in front of Dr. Rawls.
I apologize to Dr. Rawls.
Well, wait.
What?
Hold up. Wait, no.
He is a surgeon.
No.
If he wanted to, he could operate. No, isn't that how it
works? No, not a surgeon.
You know what? I wish he would do surgery on this film, go back and recut it, and put my stuff back in.
Oh, see?
What was this about?
Oh, you wound up on the cutting room?
Oh, floor? I'm all over that floor. No, I'm not the only one.
Oh.
What is that? What is that?
But I talked to other guys.
Oh.
So everyone's getting together and getting bitter over Anchorman?
It happens in movies. It happens.
I don't know why. I thought everything we ever did would wind up in this picture.
That's ridiculous.
That's delusional.
It was inferred.
Delusional.
Yes.
Then why'd we shoot it?
Why do we? So you thought when we did four takes of the same dialogue, all of them would be in the movie?
Yes.
Oh. I don't even. Yeah.
See,
Lou,
even Dr. Rawls. Even Dr. Rawls
that,
agrees with us.
I remember when.
Lou.
Yes.
Go ahead.
I remember when I cut my first album. You know, and that was before they got all the digital stuff. So I was in the editing room when they were doing the editing on the album, and I kept seeing the guy pulling, zoop, he'd pull out about a foot of tape, and he'd take a razor and cut it. And I said, whoa, man, would you know where you cut in the right place? And I wound up, I must say, I was up to my ankles in tape.
Oh, man.
On the floor. Man, he thought I was going to have a heart attack, man.
See there? Said, Lou Rawls agrees with me.
No, he doesn't.
Oh, he just said he did as much.
No, but the thing of it was, when the guy got through, he knew what he was doing.
He knew what he was doing. He put it
exactly. Together. That's what he's saying. I know what I'm doing.
I'm not disagreeing with you about the fact that you own the cutting room floor, because I've been there.
Lou is saying
and he's saying
he wishes,
deal with it. He's saying deal with it.
He's saying he wishes the guy that cut his first album cut this movie. That's what he's saying.
He's saying, do you have any brown loafers you got from the thrift store? Now get on with your life.
I do have some brown loafers.
Go back with your mangy dog and your brown loafers.
How dare you?
Oh, man.
Man.
I'm here in bare feet, coming to you.
No, I can see that.
Begging you to recut this movie.
We're not going
to
do it.
And who do I have to talk? I'm clearly talking to the wrong people. I want what is mine. I want every take I did. You got every take.
There you are.
You
you're on the screen
see,
right now.
Right there.
I looked away. I looked back. Why am I not in
you're
this
You're offset here.
Why
you were hanging out by the monitor.
We could have used the wide shot. I guess that's what I'm saying. We should have used all the wide shots.
Oh, this is... You're looking really desperate right now,
I mean,
and you're looking like you don't know what
Steven
you're talking
Spielberg
about.
You Spielberg if you want.
I got a word for you, Adam McKay. Rookie.
You do not call me a rookie.
I just did.
You do not call me a rookie.
I hope the microphone's picked it up. You are a rookie.
Dr. Rawls, once again, I hate that you have to see this. This is part of being a director. I will piss all over you, ace.
Wow.
You have way too much pubic hair.
Actually, that's a point of pride. I'm very proud of my mane of pubic hair, so thank you.
You know what? I'll enjoy it.
Oh.
Maybe we should capture that on film and broadcast it on the internet.
I'm not going to do that.
I'm going to get the original copy of this film, and I'm going to cut my own film, and I'm going to show it on the street when I'm selling my shoes and ask people, see, don't you think this should have been in the movie?
That is a sad script you've written for yourself, my friend. That... 10 years from now, I see you doing that. That is going to be ugly.
10 years from now, that's how they're going to show movies, with men selling shoes on the streets with their children and a mangy dog and a small projector, and that's how we'll watch films.
That is
how it will be done.
You should hear yourself.
I am going to start a revolution.
Are you going to have video cassettes?
Yes.
By the way, you can't see Dave right now. He is shirtless and has a giant oil stain across his chest. He looks absolutely deranged.
I am prepping myself with my oils.
Your nose is shattered, by the way. You've got actually a piece of bone coming out of your broken nose.
I got in a fight.
You got duct tape over your nose.
Here's, look. Oh, I don't know. Dave Koechner.
Well, that scene, that's pretty good. I really enjoyed that scene, and I enjoyed working with Will on that scene. I think it was very effective, and there should have been more of that.
I think we shot this on the last day, didn't we, this scene? Uh-huh.
You know what? From that day is the day we should have restarted. The last day.
Oh, that's crazy.
You're an idiot.
Well, am I? Look right there on the screen and call me an idiot.
Throw out 45 days of shooting and start with the last day?
So, you know what? It's like rehearsing for a play. You guys ever heard of rehearsing for a play? Lou, when you go to cut an album or a CD,
right.
I mean, do you just go and do it, or do you rehearse for a while and then go lay it down?
You prepare.
Okay.
You know, but then... That's because you don't want to go in there and spend all your money on studio time.
Thank you.
You know.
Thank you. Why thank you?
He no way bolstered
anything. He didn't bolster your point at all.
He just agreed with me. Who is this? Lou and I are the only ones in this room in sync, I'll tell you that.
Well, you see, that's the deal.
No, I think Lou thinks you're a jackass.
Yeah, he does.
Yes.
Don't put words in Lou's mouth.
No, don't do that.
I think General Rawls thinks you're a jackass.
Well,
you know
general.
What?
Hello.
You become a general now.
All right.
Oh, Lou? Did I say general? Are you an honorary? Can you become a general?
He could. You know what?
Secretary
Lou, I'm glad you're here. You know what we ought to do?
What?
You and I, it's what people want is a duet, like an old blues tune.
Oh, no. I don't
about
want to
our situation.
Uh-oh.
You know how you and I have been...
It's gone from scatting to low-down, dirty, gut-bucket blues.
Yep.
Low down dirty, gut bucket blues. I'm now on the street and I have to sell shoes because I was cut from this film. All my good stuff's on the floor.
Oh, Lou.
Take it, Lou.
You don't have to.
Yes, Lou and I were cut from this film.
Actually, Lou, you do. You
and
do
now they're trying to show us the door. Yeah. Take it, Lou. You and I should have been in this film together.
We should have been in it together.
We should have been in it together.
We should have got it right.
Yeah!
If we knew what we was doing, it would have been all right.
Oh! Yeah. But these guys messed it up. Their names are Adam and Will. They messed it up. They messed it up. Adam and Will shouldn't have even been a part of this experience.
Well,
yeah, that's...
Damn, they had
that was an amen.
Say what he did not say amen.
I was going to say, if they hadn't been in it, it wouldn't have been a film at all.
Thank you.
He agreed with me.
I've got to go the other way, see.
He's saying it's not a film at all.
Well, no, I didn't say that. It's a film. That's why we're sitting here...
I tell you what, I guess my position is the same as yours, that it's not really a film, and I don't want to say it's a film. It's an assemblage of things that could have been something. I think that's where we're at, Lou.
Well,
it could have been something.
The shots that I see you in, you look, you know, you're pretty cool.
All right, let me ask you this.
Did you hear what he just said?
Leave Lou alone, you two. Get your hands off of him.
You're not listening to...
We're having a dialogue. So what you're saying, what I'm hearing you say is, when you see me on the screen, you enjoy it.
Yes.
Ergo, you just want more of that.
Wasn't what you're saying.
Well...
That can definitely be culled from that conversation.
Do you remember shooting this, Davey?
Uh-huh.
It was 102 degrees in a parking lot in downtown Los Angeles. We shot this whole thing in one day.
You know what?
They look really cool. I mean, you know. Want to dance? In 102 degrees? Full of dress? Hello!
Huh?
Whoops.
Yeah. This is where they take it up a notch, Lou.
Whoops.
Do you know anything about taking it up a notch?
Whoops.
Yeah. It gets serious.
Oh, hey.
Why did I get brass knuckles? I should have got a really good...
Oh, come on, Dave.
You know, something.
Brass knuckles are pretty...
Can't really swing that.
What is this, the Battle of the Anchormen?
Yeah.
Oh.
I guess I would have shot it a little differently, but it's okay.
How so?
How so?
Yeah.
There's a few things.
You know...
Wait. Don't forget Channel 2 News.
This should have been the whole movie. Should
he was
have
in
one
the
big
old
battle.
School with Will.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Luke Wilson.
And that guy over his right shoulder?
Drew Carey.
Drew Carey.
Yeah.
Drew Carey's brother, Len Carey.
Len Carey.
Who, you know what, was cut from this film, too. Should have been more in the film.
It's Tim Robbins in his Doctor Who wig.
Yeah.
Yep. The PBS anchor.
We should redub some of this stuff right now.
This is...
Spanish language news.
Spanish language news is here. Tonight's top story. The sewers run red.
Why do they have more dudes in their gang than everybody else?
I think it's
a good point.
It just happened. That's just slightly lazy filmmaking. If you see when he comes up there, he actually loses a couple guys.
I noticed that.
I'm glad Lou...
I guess a couple of guys decided...
he disappeared.
They better get back over.
Yeah. We're starting to see the crease now, aren't we, Lou?
What was that guy's name? Ken Stiller? Is that his name? Ken?
I think it's...
Ken Stiller. There's Ken Stiller.
Ben?
I think it's Ken, Lou. Ken? I don't want to correct you, but... Ken Stiller.
No, I think Lou's right.
He has a look.
Ken Stabler?
No. That was the Oakland Raiders.
Oh, right.
It's a snake right there.
Ken Stiller.
LSU?
LSU. Yeah, they're going to throw down hard here. Have you ever seen an actual gang fight? Has anyone here ever seen a gang fight?
I've been in several.
Oh.
Have you? They throw down hard here.
Funny Paul fell that time.
Oh, yeah.
You
can actually see Rudd fall in the
mess. This is a very realistic moment.
The weird thing is we shot this as a joke, and then later we heard there were several bloody Anchorman rumbles that took place in the 70s.
Anchorman on fire.
Yeah, this was actually way more realistic than we thought.
Oh, wait a minute. Where'd the horses come from?
They had them.
My son saw this movie and was really worried that we lost one of our guys.
Really?
About the net. Fucking loud in the theater. Is that one of your guys? Oh. What happened to him? I said, it's okay, because the other guy threw a trident and got the guy in the heart.
Oh, that's smart.
Lou, that happened.
Quickly caught up.
Yeah.
It ratcheted back the logic.
Oh.
This kind of stuff,
you know,
went down.
Now that's realistic, though, because when you hear the sirens, boy, all of a sudden it just becomes as clean as a whistle.
Yep.
That used to happen in Chicago. There'd be a bunch of dudes standing on the corner.
That's Miller High Life right there.
Wrong brand.
Oh.
What would happen? There'd be dudes.
There'd be a bunch of dudes standing on the corner. And all they'd have to do, they'd have to hear, you know, a siren. They'd just see the car come around the corner.
And
it'd be like,
yeah,
a big wind go,
yeah,
and they'd, yeah, be gone.
Mr. Rawls, Dr. Rawls, we want to thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you very much. I don't know why I was here, but
what do you think of the movie, just from what you saw? I mean,
you think it's a train wreck, don't you?
I think, no, actually, it's what can I say, interesting scenario of movie making.
Could have been a little better, though. I think that's what he said at the end. Could have been a little better.
Do you know Timothy McCreary from the Wichita Times called it a masterpiece and a seminal work of artistic movie making? He said, move over Citizen Kane, you've got company. And then of Anchorman, yeah.
That's pretty good, huh?
Yeah.
He also said this is like a great Lou Rawls album.
He did.
Oh.
At one point.
Well... Hello.
He said the movie theater he saw it in, the speakers were broken, so Lou Rawls' music played the entire time they were watching the movie.
Oh, really?
It made it 10 times better.
Right. And yeah. What was it? The song was You'll Never Find?
Yeah. Coulda, woulda, shoulda.
Right. Good title.
Well, thank you for joining us.
Lou.
Thank you, guys.
It.
I appreciate the invitation to come in and witness this. Big deal. I am very prepared. Okay.
Why did you have a hard time thinking of the word you wanted to say?
He was going
to
say debacle.
I didn't want to say that.
He was going
to
say symposium.
He wanted to say debacle.
He was going
to
say intellectual symposium.
He was going to say this train wreck, this mess.
This life-changing piece of art.
This would be something that they could use as a way to become an anchor man.
Yeah.
An instructional tape.
Yes. A documentary on...
That's the way we feel.
The life of an
anchor man. Except David obviously feels differently.
Well, I think what they're going to do is take this as a puzzle. And they're going to give it to school children, and they're giving them all the assemblage, and go, say, here, we know this isn't the best film it could have been. Why don't you put it together? And no, those kids will put it together, and I will be back in the film. Right.
School children.
And I'll be an anchor man.
Oh, that's pathetic, hey, man. That is.
Whammy. Whammy.
All right.
There, I said it.
All right. Well, all I can tell you, Dr. Rawls, is next time we do this, we will once again invite you back.
Well, I would look forward to that. Oops.
Yeah.
Wow.
I can't wait till Lou and I get in the recording
special
studio.
Special effects are great.
Lou, do you think you and I probably do a duet, work something up? I like to sing.
Wow.
The old typewriter to the head.
Yeah.
Lou, next time you're in the studio, just give me a call. And
he's not even responding to you, Dave.
We will put something together.
Not even.
He's not even...
You know what?
Yeah.
Lou's kind of digging this fight.
Yeah. This was actually a well-articulated... Ooh, Mace.
Jeez.
Yeah, we could really make some music.
Whoa.
Mace never... She's very resourceful.
Good stuff.
Applegate kicks Will's ass.
Oh, man. This must have been a lot of fun.
It was.
I thought that fun would continue, but...
Except... for dealing with David.
Well, should we take a little bathroom break? And once again, Lou Rawls.
Once again, thank you very much for the invitation.
Thank you, Lou.
Let's get in that studio.
Hey, buddy.
You and I.
All right.
Yeah, he just said already, Adam.
You don't have to.
You know.
I don't have to.
No.
Actually,
no,
he didn't.
He's already means like, exactly. Yeah, in your dreams kind of thing.
Oh.
Well, I think that went good.
That was a treat.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I kind of... It's Lou Rawls. That was intimidating.
I got a little nervous. I'm not gonna lie to you.
I've had dinner with Kofi Annan from the UN. I've spent weekends at about six different presidents' ranches.
A lot of impressive people.
I'm not. It's not even name dropping. I just have.
No. You know,
No, I know.
And that's the most nervous I've ever been around anyone.
It was Lou Rawls sitting here.
Yeah.
You don't want to.
I went on a bicycle trip with Norm Nixon, the former point guard from the Lakers, and I remember that being pretty
kind
tense.
Of a big deal for the first 10 minutes on the bike.
Oh, it's Norm Nixon.
Yeah.
Hey, I wanted to, we talked about the Eskimo movie, which you seemed jazzed about, which was cool, and Lou seemed to really like.
No, I don't.
Which was cool. It's fun to hear that excitement in your voice.
I don't think I seem jazz. If I did, anyway.
It's just fun. It just reminds me of Tuesday nights right into SNL.
Yeah.
It had that really fresh feeling to it. But I had another idea, too, which is great for you because animated, the Pixar stuff is really big. Uh-huh. And it's a story about a purple cyclops, and it's called Bleck. And it's just about this cyclops that kind of falls in love with another cyclops, but you think she's a princess, and then... But it's just a whole animated
It's like
kind
Shrek.
Of, huh?
Sounds exactly what you're pitching.
I'm not going to lie to you. It's similar to Shrek because if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But this is different. This is Bleck. Honestly, we might even just call it Shrek.
Yeah, you can't do that.
I think you can.
I mean, unless you were going to change the spelling of the title, but then they probably
would. I wouldn't want to do that because I want people to think it was Shrek.
Yeah, you're not going to. They're going
to
sue you.
Take us to court then. While they're taking us to court, we're making $300 million.
Okay, well. Regardless, I don't even know why I'm arguing with you. I'm not going to do it. It's really just a copy and kind of a stupid idea. So
you know what? You might be right. Let's just stick with Eskimo in New York.
Yeah, I'm not doing Eskimo in New York, by the way. Even if you thought Lou Rawls liked it or whatever.
By the way, did you get nervous? I was afraid he was going to notice that there aren't any black people in the movie.
I don't think he noticed. I think Rudd comes off as African American.
Mm-hmm.
I think he thought Rudd was black.
Well, I've always kind of thought that.
In fact, I think Rudd might even be black and doesn't kind of deal with it. But, he also knows that was a white world, and it's the whole point is that it was white men.
Yeah.
It was.
In fact, I don't want to tell you that, but on the way out, he said to me, he pulled me aside, and he's like, Adam McKay, I got to tell you, you really nailed that whole era. You really showed a pivotal point in our history. And
wow.
He's like, you got your friend over there making the funny faces to get the people laughing, but you really did the work. And it was just a little moment. I was like, coming from Lou Rawls, that's so cool. It was just great. It was in the hallway. It was kind of tight in there. And he just kind of whispered in my ear. He's like, I'm Lou Rawls. And as far as I'm concerned, you're a pretty cool guy, Adam McKay.
He kept you.
And he said,
He kept using both your names?
He's like, you're a pretty cool guy, Adam McKay. I mean it. Anytime you want to hang with me. He's like, you got your buddy over there making funny faces and fart sounds. That'll get them laughing to get the people in, but you're the one with the real. He said, what he said to me? He said, you got a deep soul, Adam McKay. And he gave me like a little mini neck rub. He's like,
yeah, because I, the only thing is I've been with you. I was with you the whole time you were with Lou. So I don't know when that exchange could have taken place. I mean, if he did say that, great.
That's the cool thing is there's no argument because he did. So it's like, logically what you say kind of makes sense, I guess. But he did say it. So.
No, it's good for you. That's so great. What a cool moment.
Really cool moment. Really cool moment. And he said, and your buddy in there in the movie, the dwarf. And I said, no, the elf. He's like, he really makes some funny faces.
Yeah.
And he must have a weird muscle, extra muscle in his face that makes his face look that funny. And he said, you're a heavy dude. He said, you got an old soul.
Right.
He said, you remind me of a philosopher blues king like Robert Johnson or something.
He actually said that?
Yeah.
That's great. That's an amazing thing.
It was great.
What a special moment.
And then he said, good luck with Eskimo in New York. He said, that's really going to be something special. He said, I got a little glint in my eye like I was 15 again when I heard that idea. It just felt fresh to me.
I don't know how many times I have to tell you this, but I'm not doing Eskimo in New York.
You know what? We'll set it up, put it in development, write the script, go into pre-production, and then you see how you feel. And I think that's the best way to play it. We should go back to doing the commentary. I think they started rolling again.
So.
These things are bullshit anyway, these commentaries.
Total bullshit.
I know, everyone acts like
that. Does anyone ever listen to them?
I don't think so.
Have you ever listened to one?
Not ever.
Really?
No. Why would you? It's like you watch the movie, things happen, you respond to it, and then you're done.
I listened to the one on Camelot.
Oh, is that good?
The soundtrack. There's a commentary, the original musical Camelot.
Well, that could be interesting. I like that, the one with Charlie Sheen, that Men at Work.
Oh, right, the the trash can guy?
Yeah,
the,
I watched
the
that.
Garbage man?
That's, I was wrong. That's the only commentary. I've watched that commentary many, many times.
Right.
Well, you know, the, I have those guys we let rent the guest house, the carriage house behind our house, and they make crystal meth. And they sell it out of there, and I'm cool with it. I don't care. They pay the rent. They can
no, I'm cool. I'm totally cool with it.
Totally cool with it.
By the way, I'm just to let you know, I'm totally cool with that.
And,
as a friend.
Why did you say you're totally cool with it again?
I just want you to know that I'm totally cool
with
crystal meth production.
And here's the thing. They throw me some every now and then, so I've been up. Like, last month, I was up for 14 straight days. Finally, I had a heart attack, because the only way I went to sleep. And I'll just do crystal meth, and I'll watch I'll listen to the commentary for Men at Work over and over again. I listen to the commentary for Men at Work for 5 straight days.
Hey, you watch yourself, mister. Hey, lady in the red hat. Yeah.
I think we're very proud of what's on the screen here.
Well, there's the term, and I didn't know it because it was my first movie, but they call it a passion project,
right.
I guess is the term they use in the industry.
It's called a passion project.
And this was really bad. I mean, this was... Oh, this was...
This is part of Ron Burgundy's down-and-out sequence here, and... little-known fact, it was shot down in San Pedro.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. We made the trek.
Yeah. And I think Shira... Did your wife Shira come down that day to visit the set?
She did. She's with my baby daughter.
Yeah.
They come up to you, and she's the one who says you are truly a disappointment to us all, Mr. Burgundy. Which
it was always great when Shira would come by the set.
Yeah, well, it's
she's
fun.
So
it's
great.
And Lily, and it's just great to have my family there. You know,
she's just great. She's great.
Thanks, man. She likes you too. It's Fred Willard again. Oh God, he's good.
What? How long have you known Shira?
We've been married for 5 years. We lived together for a couple years.
I gotta tell you, she's put together pretty nice, you know what I mean? I like the way she's put together.
Okay, stop though. My wife.
But we've never had a frank conversation about Shira. But,
I think we've had plenty of franks. She's my wife, I love her. And
she is your wife, and she is hot.
Okay. It makes me uncomfortable when you talk about her like that. So because
no, I don't mean to. I'm just saying.
Well, it just seems like you're sexualizing her and it's my wife.
No. I'm not trying to do that at all. You know. But I do like the way she moves, you know.
Oh, hey. Stop it. Just stop it. Don't even talk about her. It's my wife.
I realize that. And that's why I'm expressing, you know.
There's Seth Rogen from Freaks and Geeks.
That's right. Was Shira in the shot?
No. Mm-mm.
She should have been.
Yeah.
In like a bikini or something. That would have been nice.
Why don't we... Should we stop or something?
Stop what?
I'm really going to give you a little rap in the face if you keep doing this. Just a little knock right in the grill.
Look.
You want to keep this up. It's my wife. All right?
Fine. You don't have to get so touchy. She's a human being, you know. She probably likes compliments.
She'd like a compliment like she's an attractive lady.
Which she is. She's.
Well, there you go. You stop right there. Okay. Stop right there. Don't say anything else.
Dripping in honey. You know what I mean?
How would you like it if I talked about your wife like that? If I said, your wife's a nice big old slice of heaven.
I would love it. I would love it. That would just reinforce the fact that I made a right choice in the mating department.
Oh, okay. So just overall, you're gross. I thought it was like specifically about my wife. But overall, you have some issues about... The way you view women.
Do you guys get it on a lot? You like getting it on?
So this is with Danny Trejo, right? The bartender?
Do you like to get it on?
There he is. People always took this scene as kind of serious. They would be kind of quiet in the theater, and it actually makes me laugh about as hard as anything in the movie.
Do you do shoulder rubs?
Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. It's my family, all right?
Jeez.
What? There's not many things that are going to bother me, but that's one of them. That's right high up on the list.
Whatever.
You want to be weird about my wife or my daughter, then that's
whatever.
That's about it. It's a short list.
Hey, that is a fantastic shot you got there.
I didn't know I was hanging out with Jerry Falwell.
That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous.
The moral majority.
You don't know how to behave right, and you act like I'm uptight.
I don't.
I asked you 8 times, nice and calm. 8 times, stop talking about my wife like that. Even if I
took that to mean you wanted me to keep that you enjoyed it,
you're enjoying the attention that your wife's getting. Subsequently, you're getting that same attention. I thought that meant you wanted me to keep.
I don't know. That doesn't make any sense. How would you possibly confuse what I said with keep it up? Please stop, I said.
Anyway.
Yeah, anyway. There's Chris Parnell.
This is actually, did you talk about this set that was built?
This is actually this whole set was built in the, basically in the middle of the park, nothing there at all. And they built this set in like 2 days, an entire zoo, basically.
And they used a construction team of hot, scantily clad ladies.
Didn't they? No.
Guess who the foreman was?
I swear to God, if you say my wife, I'm gonna frickin' pounce on you.
Just guess who the foreman was of the hot ladies.
Her name was, I don't know, Sharon Wilson.
Close.
If you say my wife, I'm gonna really hurt you. I'm gonna crack your faceplate if you say it's my wife.
What? My nose is already badly.
I know. I'm gonna
pulverized.
Lace both my fingers together and with a double fist crack your faceplate if you say my wife.
This is quite an emotional moment.
This is
for Ron Burgundy as he gets invited back to join the news team.
I remember you had to get your sense memory going on this. We had to clear the set. This was tough for you, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You were drawing on some painful memories of your father and
my guardian.
Hello?
My guardian, Will? Gary. Hello?
Will?
Yeah?
Adam?
Who is that?
Who's this?
It's Christina.
Oh, Christina!
Oh, hey, Christina.
Guys.
How are you doing? What's up?
I'm good. I'm a little surprised you're doing the commentary without me there.
Oh.
Crappy. That's kind of crappy.
You know what, though?
Oh.
I mean.
It's not really like that. It's been pretty. It's really just been us. I mean, it's been us and Lou Rawls and Andy Richter and Dave Koechner, and that's
Rawls?
Really.
Lou Rawls.
Yeah.
Movie? What did he have to do with the movie?
He's Lou Rawls, though.
It was just a great opportunity to sit down with him, and finally get a lot of questions answered.
Just kind of thought it was like an important aspect to the filmmaking.
Oh, no one's saying you weren't.
People wanted to maybe hear what my thoughts on everything were, but whatever.
No, Christina, that's definitely the case. I mean,
I didn't even know you guys were doing this. Like, my neighbor just told me you guys were doing this.
Oh, yeah. Dan, your neighbor's a sweetheart.
He's a sweetheart.
It's weird.
He came by earlier.
Because I know that we had sent a messenger over.
No, there was no.
With, like, a handwritten note that said we may do it today.
No, I think.
I'll own up.
It's cool. I mean, I've been around for a long time, I didn't just, fall off the...
No, you're a complete and total professional.
You know what I'm saying? Like, the vegetable truck. I didn't just...
Turnip truck.
Yeah, turnip truck.
Yeah, whatever. You call it turnip.
It's not whatever. It's a turnip truck is the way the phrase goes.
I don't know. I'm from California. You're from where? Midwest somewhere?
No, Philadelphia.
We do it differently here. But anyway,
Guys, please.
It's the same thing, because I'm a girl.
Turnip truck.
And girls aren't funny, and girls have no opinion, and they have no point of view, and, they're just there to, have their boobs out or something, right? That's what it is.
Well, no, that is a function for sure.
I mean, you're an attractive woman, Christina, you shouldn't deny that, but that's not all you are, of course.
No, it seems like it's all I am to you guys, but that's okay.
I'm not going to lie to you.
I'm always invited to the DVD commentaries, on every movie that I'm in.
Right.
Whether or not I had a speaking role or not, just because...
Can we be honest? From the commentaries I've heard, it just seems like a little bit like a man's world. Like,
I'm a little hurt.
The deeper voice resonates better against the movie.
Right. It's more a technical issue than it is, who's in the movie, who's not.
Bull crap. I know exactly what it is.
Look, Christina.
Oh.
It's cool. You guys, it's fine. I mean, 2 months of this. I had 2 months of ridicule and, But
no, it got hard. That's what we were talking about earlier.
I've studied acting for my whole life, I'm a real actor.
I saw a bunch of movies before I directed this, Christina, so I put my time in too. And
I mean, I just want you to know that
Lou
we...
Rawls?
It's... Christina, it's Lou Rawls.
It's Lou Rawls.
Have anything to
and
do
Dave
with
Koechner.
Me.
I mean...
Well, Koechner's there?
Yeah, Koechner came by, and Kyle Gass, and Andy Richter. Paul Rudd.
Andy Richter?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What? He's not...
He was mad because we didn't cast
yeah,
him.
Yeah, he was... Boy, they unloaded on us.
All these people there, and you guys didn't call me.
And your neighbor, Dan, came by.
And we talked to your mother briefly. She came by. She was real sweet. We hadn't had time to sit down with her.
Wow. Interesting.
But those are just things that just happened kind of in the ether.
Yeah, Christina, I mean...
They weren't premeditated.
Yeah, it is, you know. You yell cut, it's a wrap, and, you know, you just kind of... You just throw me off. Just throw me off into, like, nothingness.
Oh, no.
That's not...
Alone. With my dog and me, and that's it, you know? Like, I just feel really... Like, you guys just, like, left me out here to dry.
That's a bit melodramatic, Chris. Come on.
It left me out to, in the grass.
Wait, Christina, I hate to interrupt, but these bears were real bears.
Real, actual real bears.
And look, I mean, that's...
That's a Kodiak.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I almost got...
But I'm sorry, Christine, what were you saying?
Yeah, I almost was... Those bears were really scary, guys. And
you know, we already got that covered, Christine.
It was fair that I had to work with the real bears and you guys got to work with, like, guys in bear suits, you know? Because...
That was just the scheduling thing.
Yeah.
The bears...
The bears were tired.
They would get cranky later in the day when Will would work, and they were fresher when you would come in.
No, I think this is like, you know, it'd be funny if, like, the chick gets killed by the bear, and then we get it on film, and then we put it in there, and you get, like, you know, a whole other audience.
Christina,
is what I think.
I did not know you heard that conversation.
That way,
yeah. Well,
that was a private conversation I had with one of the producers. I had no idea you were listening.
Yeah. Well,
That was taped, actually, though, Adam. And
was
submitted.
It?
You had it submitted on a... You had it burned on a CD and passed out to everyone.
No, I forgot I did that. That's right. Christina, I don't know how to make this right. I really don't. I can offer a few things. I mean,
We're already arranging to have a fruit basket sent over.
I can also send over an envelope with about six $20 bills in it.
I'm thinking fruit, people. I just need a little respect. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, you know? It's my motto, and if you don't want to live by it, then, like...
No, you have it tattooed on your back. We know it's your motto. And that's what
then,
no pun
know,
intended, that's what we respect about you.
Now go walk out the door. Because you know what? Guess what, guys? You're not welcome anymore. That's how I'm feeling today.
Oh, no, Christina, don't. I mean, the way I feel is, you know, convoy.
We got a big old convoy trucking on down the line. We got a big old convoy. Ain't she a beautiful sight?
I mean, that's just where we're coming from.
You know what I have to say that to all of that is, okay, forget it.
Christina, we just want to make this right with you.
We just
want to
make it right.
I want $2 million.
Oh, no, come on.
Oh, jeez.
I'll give you
$100. That's ridiculous.
You know how much this movie made?
$120.
I want $2 million in cash.
$180.
In ones. No, I don't. $180, no.
That's a lot of money, Christina. You don't
give
get.
Give me $2 million. I'll stop harassing you.
What? It...
All right. I'll stop leaving the dead fish on your doorstep.
Oh, that was you.
Yeah.
Adam's stepkid Ryan has a mobile dog grooming service, mm-hmm. And he has these vans that can show up at your house anytime. We want to give your dog a free grooming.
No, I want $2 million.
How about I send Ryan by and we make your dog look all nice and pretty? And you never call or talk to us again.
Done
deal. Oh, that's nice. Oh my God, I can't believe we got away. I was very close to giving you the $2 million.
No, I want it anyway. I'm so glad.
Ryan is gonna take care of your pooch. What's your dog's name again?
Good. I'm not telling you her
Bongo?
Name. Yeah, Bongo.
Dr. Bongo?
Bongo Jeans.
Bongo Jeans.
But thanks, guys. That makes it better.
That's all we wanted to do, Christine. We just wanted to heal wounds.
Appreciate that. You guys are great.
A lot of wounds. This was not a pleasant shoot. Everyone knows
it. No, it wasn't.
Yeah,
a lot of wounds.
Today
we
a lot of tears stain the ground of our shooting floor.
Yeah, and staining other, you know, things too, like chairs and stuff too.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Not just the ground, but...
A lot of bodily fluid staining a lot of objects during the shoot.
That was, you know, I have a problem with my bladder, and that's not, you know, it's not funny to talk about it, man.
It's not at all funny.
No. it's a personal thing, and it's
very personal. You're right now we're watching the screen, and Will is doing his final sign off the Panda Store. It's a very emotional scene. I remember shooting it.
I didn't like that scene too much. No offense, Will, but I just didn't think it was really, you know, it wasn't like groundbreaking or anything. It's sort of whatever.
Well, it's sort of supposed to be a reference to typical third act ending. I mean, it wasn't supposed to be groundbreaking.
Oh.
Man.
Wasn't my favorite.
That's just... You're going to take shots at the film on the commentary?
Well, if I was there, I mean, it would be different. But since I can't really see it, because I'm here at home, like, on the phone, you know?
Right.
Like, I can't see...
Well, I mean, I think it's only fair, Adam, for you and I to give Miss Applegate the floor here. And to...
All right.
I mean, I think we just...
All right.
The rest of the time.
All right. All right.
Let Christina get off anything, anything she has on her.
All right. Here's the deal,
chest.
Christina. We're gonna lay it down real clean and simple.
Any stories she wants to tell?
Ryan's not coming to your house to groom your dog. That's off the table now. But we give you the floor here. The commentary, all yours, for the remainder of the movie. Say whatever you want to say. Any kind of story, we stay completely out of your way. But Ryan does not come. My stepson does not come to groom your dog. I repeat, Ryan does not come with his van.
So I can say whatever I want.
You can say whatever you want once we say that the floor is clear. It's all Christina Applegate time. That's it.
Okay.
No Bill Farrell. No Alan McKay. Just Christina Applegate.
Okay.
So, go ahead, Miss Christina Applegate.
Anchorman. The Legend of Ron Burgundy, a film commenting on the political
agendas. That's it. That movie's over.
Yeah. Sorry, Christina.
Booyakasha!
That's low rent, Missy. Did you hear what I said?
I'm outie.
That is low rent, Missy.
Yeah, well, you know, that's the deal.
We love you, Christina Applegate.
I love you guys, too. I mean, with all the agreements we had, you know.
From all of us here at the World News Center, I'm Veronica Corningstone.
And I'm Ron Burgundy. You stay classy, Planet Earth.
Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
Oh, great Odin's raven. Oh, by the hammer of Thor. St. Damien's beard. Sweet grandmother's spatula. Hot pot of coffee. Uncle Jonathan's corncob pipe.
I'm going to shoot you with a BB gun when you're not looking. In the back of the head.
You're not very bright, you know that, right? You're actually quite a dullard. In fact, everyone here knows it.
Well, if I'm a dullard, you're the dullard uncle.
Can't think of anything to say now, can you?
Yes, I can. I can think of a lot of things to say, like you're a dirty bitch.
Well, Ron, I'm gonna put poison.
I drank a lava lamp. It wasn't lava. I ate a whole bunch of fiberglass insulation. It wasn't cotton candy like that guy said. My stomach's itchy. I pooped a hammer. I pooped a tape recorder. I pooped a Cornish game hen.
Nope. You do not take a tone with me, because I will give you a rap right on the Jack Johnson.
Okay.
Yes.
Now this is happening.
What are you doing? What? Ah! What are you doing? What are you?
I guess we'll go back to doing what I do best. I guess we'll go back to doing what I do best. Show off.
When do we get started?
When do we get started?
That's my line.
When do we get started?
That's my line. You say whenever you like.
Whenever you like. So I keep it rolling. This is good stuff.
Yeah, I like this. I'm gonna area bank in a daring early morning. Probably not the same one. Probably not the same guy.
Brick, before I let you go, are you still having your celebrity golf tournament this summer?
No, too many people died last year, so we're not gonna do it. Sorry.
They named it San Diego, which in German means a whale's vagina.
This is the most ridiculous thing ever.
Good to be number one.
Yeah, well, it sure beats the hell out of number two.
We are laughing. And we are very good friends. Good buddies sharing a special moment.
Yeah. Don't say anything wrong, just let it happen.
Laughing and enjoying our friendship.
And someday we'll look back on this with much fondness.
Yeah.